Hello students, UGC NET students and dear students who are also aspiring for IES mains in English literature 2019. As I have already told all of you that I am going to start my new batch of IES mains in English literature very soon. So all those aspirants who are watching me here, so they may come in contact with me as soon as possible, because you have to complete your course before even you qualify your pre-examination. So today I have come here with a lecture which is basically a very, you know, basic lecture of literature, which is known as the nature of literature, or what is literature and its nature. So this lecture would not only help IES aspirants, but all those students who are even in their BA, MA, PhD or any place, they should be only student of literature. So what is literature? Literature grows out of life. It reacts upon life and it is fed by life. It grows out of life, it reacts upon life, and it is fed by life. And in spite of this, to define literature is a very difficult task, friends. The scope of literature is so vast, so vast, कि उसको हम एक सिंगल फॉर्मूला में रिड्यूस नहीं कर सकते. इट इज जस्ट इम्पॉसिबल टू रिड्यूस इट इन अ फॉर्मूला और इन अ सेंटेंस ऑफ इट्स ओन. समबडी हैज सेड दैट लिटरेचर कंप्राइजेस इवन ऑफ थियोलॉजी, मेडिसिन, जुरिसप्रूडेंस एसेट्रा. एंड चार्ल्स लैम, the king of the prince of English essayist, he has narrowed the conception of literature and excludes the works of Hume and Gibbon, although many literary historians have included them. Matthew Arnold has defined literature as the artistic expression of the best that is known and thought in the world. De Quincey has drawn a distinction between literature of knowledge and the literature of power. All that is literature seeks to communicate power. All that is not literature to communicate knowledge. There is first the literature of knowledge and secondly the literature of power. The function of the first means knowledge, is to teach, and the function of the second, that is power, is to move. The first is the rudder and the second is the oar, or you can say sail. The first speaks to the mere discursive understanding, and the second speaks, ultimately it may happen, to the higher understanding or reason, but always through affections of pleasure and sympathy. Books of religion, books of philosophy, science, history, and economics, politics, or morals may be described as the literature of knowledge, while the plays of Shakespeare and the poetry of Keats are considered to be literature of power. There is no denying the fact that literature is intimately related to society, and which is the outcome of civilization. Literature, judged from that point of view, reflects the entire culture of the people. Literature is a group of activity, and the group may be called the race. The society and civilization, the system of social organization, the class structure, and the deeply rooted institutions will always leave a deep impression upon the men of letters, padhe likhe logon pe, and their pattern of thought and expression, and the entire social process is reflected in literature. So now we have to determine the criteria of literature. Often writers or readers, they arbitrarily dismiss certain books, that this is not literature, this is not literature. Some critic has referred and he has said that books on theology, jurisprudence, logic and mathematics are even literature. They are accommodating readers and critics who considers book on history, philosophy, even science as literature. You must have heard the name Gibbon, Edward Gibbon, History of the Decline and Fall of Roman Empire. A great monumental work has been accepted by a number of critics as pure literature and a supreme work of prose. Hobbes and Locke are eminent philosophers, but their works are distinct contributions to literature. Come to Charles Darwin, Origin of Species, The Descent of Man may be regarded as excellent scientific literature. And we cannot imagine a literary history without a sympathetic treatment of Hume, Berkeley, Gibbon, Adam Smith, Darwin, Huxley, and even Bertrand Russell. But the literary historians, by and large, are rather niggardly in their treatment, although they are rhapsodical about the poets, about the dramatists, novelists, and essays. The literary historians, therefore, have failed in their missions because of their discussion of the philosophers and scientists in a very fragmentary fashion. Language or style gives literature its distinctive stamp. ये बात फैक्ट है कि लैंग्वेज और स्टाइल बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट होती है लिटरेचर को उसका अपनी जगह दिखाने की, उसको एक स्टैम्प देने की. एंड अ डिस्टिंक्शन देयरफॉर हैज टू बी ड्रॉन बिटवीन द रिटन वर्ड्स एंड स्पोकन वर्ड्स. व्हाट इज लिटरेचर? लिटरेचर इज द एक्सप्रेशन ऑफ द रिटन वर्ड्स एंड स्पोकन वर्ड्स आर मियर ब्रेथ एंड दे लीव नो रिकॉर्ड. सो वी कैन डेफिनेटली से that literature is a permanent record. Thought and expression must go together. If we find any rhetorical flourishes in the plays of Shakespeare, we must concede that it is only an adequate rendering of thought, and great subjects justify an elevated style. Language cannot be superimposed upon thought. Literature is the personal use or exercise of language. That this, it is so proved from the fact that one author uses it so differently from other. While many use language as they find it, the man of genius uses it indeed, but subjects it withal to its own purpose. हमें जैसा पर्पस की जरूरत होती है, हम उस प्रकार से उसको मोल्ड कर देते हैं, उसको उसी प्रकार से उसकी पिक्युलरिटीज को बना देते हैं. अकॉर्डिंग टू द आइडियाज, द थॉट्स, द फीलिंग्स, द इमेजिनेशंस, द स्पेकुलेशंस, द एब्स्ट्रैक्शंस, द जक्स्टापोजिशंस, द कंपैरिजंस, द डिस्क्रिमिनेशंस, द कंसेप्शंस, एंड विच आर सो ओरिजिनल ऑलवेज. सो दिस इज वॉट इज टू बी डन एंड दिस इज वॉट इज लिटरेचर. एंड लिटररी language is not merely referential. It is something more than referential. Compared to scientific language, literary language will appear in some ways deficient because it abounds in ambiguities. It is like every other historical language, full of homonyms, arbitrary or irrational categories such as grammatical gender, etc., etc. In a single word, we can say that it is highly connotative. And the real history of poetry, some critic has written, it is the history of the changes in the kind of language in which the successive poems have been written. And literary history is in consonance with linguistic history. a man's style, says Emerson, in his mind's voice, wooden minds, wooden voices. And to be familiar with the personalities is to be familiar with their styles. Agar hum kids se familiar hain, to uski style se bhi familiar hain. Wordsworth se personality se familiar hain, to uske style ko bhi jante hain. Since no literature can be absolutely impersonal, the style is personal in varying degrees. So this is what I wish to tell you about in short, that literary language has to be distinguished not only from the scientific language, but also colloquial language, the language of commerce, the language of religion. The language today has become pronouncedly informal and colloquial. Nowadays, writers avoid elegance in style, which Arnold described as the Attic style, ATTIC. Modern talk has replaced Victorian lectures delivered from the pulpit or the platform, and the study of literature poses a number of problems. The relative position of art and morality, the place of personality, and the different approaches to literature.